vodka and tonics to set you on your feet again. Maybe you found a replacement. There's plenty like me to be found. A mongrel who ain't got a penny, sniffing for tidbits like you.
And I do a whole lot of things. Today I'm singing and I'm sharing my poetry and some amazing music. So I hope you will enjoy. This next piece is 100% a true story about when my cat was placed on house arrest in Urbana, Illinois. He was a scrappy street cat with a reputation larger than life. Dave came to me one day when I was on my way to work in the middle of a torrential downpour. And he was this teeny little thing. I felt badly for him and made the choice to make him my pet. I had pity. But just before I got to the front door of my apartment, he leapt from my arms and then disappeared around a corner. Pretty sure that I cussed him out for making me late and getting me wet. I don't remember, but I should have known then that he never belonged to me. He belonged to the streets, and he was full of attitude. So we relayed to each other more like roommates rather than a kitten and their human mama should. In fact, our conversation the day that I finally brought him something like this, as he showed up in the exact same spot I found him. Yeah, I remember you. You made me late for work. I don't have time. Fuck you. Goodbye. And I went down to the subway and did not think of him again. And then suddenly, I hear a meow. And at the top of the escalator, there he is. And I said, what do you want? Meow. Are we doing this? All right, then hurry up, because you're going to make me late again. So I finally had a cat, and we named him Dave. We needed a name to put on the paperwork, and so his teenage kitty hormones were too much, and we had to deal with it. So we decided to make a joke about naming our cat after a friend, and then honor said friend by cutting off his balls. The name stuck. But then Dave became the cat that no longer gave. The neighborhood kids couldn't wait to tell me about his escapades and about how he took on that dog that was a pest down the street. The kind of asshole that changed. My cat was never to step outside again or risk arrest and termination. My cat had house arrest. A veterinarian once called Dave worst behaved than the wild wolverines that he researched. So when his body failed him, we knew we would have to sedate him to put him to sleep. So we fed him tranquilizers, human-sized tranquilizers. I shotgunned him a face full of my best weed. I took him outside to enjoy one last time, and then I swaddled him in a blanket like a delicate, precious child about to go to kitty heaven. But Dave was no child, and he had no plans on heaven. And I whispered reassuring words for him in the waiting room, and he moaned in disapproval. I cooed gently in his ear. Dave looked at me with really intense eyes, meowed loudly, lifted a weakened paw from up between the blankets, and slapped me in the face again one more time. Who knows? Maybe Dave didn't want me to cry. He was telling me to get over it. No tears. No tears for Dave. My sweet, sweet punk-ass cat who lived and died by the street code was gone. I went home and I poured tequila and libation. I put out the word that the Godfather was gone. Real G's everywhere. Join me in one final salute. Sad to see a living legend gone from us all. Yeah, well, he's now free. Yes, Black Cat Lives Matter too, by the way. All right, so that was fun. Now we're going to get a little serious. So this next piece is probably one of my best known, and it talks about misogynoir. These are the different forms of oppression, violence, and hate that happen to Black women. I'm going to dedicate this one tonight to my friend Taisha Green. She's one of many, many people that I know, one of many, many Black women that I know that have had to leave the state of Vermont, because it was not only not safe for them, but it was a place that carried too much pain to heal from. And as we're thinking about our elections, quick shout out. You have two amazing Black femmes on your ballots. If you're in the Northeast Kingdom, yes, we have Esther Charleston, who's actually, you have options. You don't have to vote for Phil Scott, for fuck's sake. We don't have time to play, people. We don't fucking have time to play. And then also, she gets little credit, but she is the only Black woman in the entire legislature taking over from my role, Saadia Lamont, out of the Northeast Kingdom. And she needs your money, she needs your help, we need your volunteerism. She's a disabled single mom. We gotta show up for her in the way that she's shown up for our state. So, let's go with Anthem. Supremacy says with a dark, sadistic grin as it presses its hand upon my face, crushing my upturned nose and chin. See, this is the only way that business works. The business of world domination. We have determined that your place in this nation is just part of a stipulation to ensure that you know where you don't belong. See, there are no true birthrights to respect or acknowledgement of your humanity, firstly, because of your race, a legacy and a system that has never seen you as truly human, equal to none and inferior to all. Inferior to all, so your allowable presence is conditional. Don't tell me that your life matters, girly, because it doesn't. All lives matter, it says, in an infantilizing tone. Not Black lives, but all lives matter, because that would require a recognition of a unique human experience that we've determined is not worthy of notice. How dare you even breathe with such grace? Each conversation must be dank, heavy, in order to be legitimate. A true bloody battle of words, but I was once told that you do not that you were invited to. So why is my existence the site of so much spiritual warfare? But we're never going to fight fair, it says. We gleefully paint ourselves with your spilt blood as the victims of your inherently true evil ways, your truth-telling, your interruptions to our superior trains of thought. See, we will talk over you. We will dismiss your ideas. We will repackage them as our own. Call it diversity and profit richly on your name. And your body, oh, your body, it fascinates. Exotic, erotic, sweet, dark chocolate is the name that sexual exploitation gives me. Dark and so different, right to be consumed like a bucket list experience. No different than a trophy elephant, slaughtered on safari, slayed, displayed for bragging rights. See, I know that I must use deliberate caution in my wardrobe so as to not incite the imaginations of those who control the lens, that ubiquitous lens that gaze at lust and disgust at my image all at the same time. Cat calls and the winks, the unintentional but blatant touches, the loaded invitation to have fun. See, it never actually was rape because you wanted it. With that round ass and that sassy mouth of yours. See, black women are insatiable and vicious. Your Africanness gives you the power of voodoo and dark, magical seduction over lazy minds. We download your porn and obsess in our fantasy, but we're gonna deny any complicity when grandma asks who shares our bed. Our women fear what you represent and wear their insecurities like a badge. A centuries-old jealousy burned in the DNA of white women. Mothers watch their husbands rape, take, and relish their dominance over women in the slave quarters, harem halls, and whorehouses of the world. How dare you stand there in defiance and lack of respectability and enjoy pleasure on your terms? Which part of objectification don't you get? You are a toy, a plaything, a trending topic. You are never to be trusted, but fully consumed and then tossed to the periphery of history. Oh, and then corporate America chimes in with a sneer. And your hair? It's just a little too revolutionary. It's so unkempt and non-white. See, the test has come time and time again that promotions in my career suit perfectly as to when I move away from black hair to appropriate whiteness. See, I must prove my commitment, my willingness to ascend above and beyond. And all of my hard work and accomplishments are beholden to someone else's whims and someone else's grace to give me what I have damn well earned. And I live in criminality, never secure that I picked whatever the twisted vision of the tribal team fit, exclusionary HR bullshit of the day that gets to dictate my professional marginalization because I just keep demanding acceptance into the places that they tell me I don't belong. And the gatekeepers hold tight the keys and they read the terms of endearment, of engagement that says you deserve but a penance and will accept far less until you prove your willingness to enter again and again and again. You will do more. You will make a way from no way. Physical destruction that causes. You have been bred through slavery, through unnatural selection, to endure too fucking much. You will dance, you will produce, until your body collapses and your fingers bleed from the sweat equity of the black American nightmare. And so I must pull the food from my child's mouth to pay the exorbitant financial price of admittance, promised through degrees, accreditation, and more proof that others are ever expected to give. It was all conditional. I mean, it was laid out in legalese. I just didn't read between the lines of the fine print of the social contract on my life. I trusted in the goodwill of the powerful and the privileged, and now I'm left bent, crushed, and quivering. And so, I fight back with the strength of 100 dark-skinned queens who were told they were pretty for a black girl. I speak louder with the conviction and ferocity of 1,000 servant women who were told they are poor because they're lazy. I blatantly call out systems of oppression with the tactical acuity of women warriors like Nanny, Tubman, Nzinga, and Shakur, and they turn on me. They join in unison to say, foolish girl, it isn't us, it's you. You have wounded our pride, and you must make us whole again. And so I fight back tears, exhausted from daily battles, tired and worn. My defeat is what they want, my acquiescence is what they need to put things into their rightful order, but I cannot be beaten unless I accept it. I know that I must rage against this machine. No longer a conscientious objector to accepting these wars, these ongoing battles for my soul here and now, and the agony that's contained within cannot be held back. I feel the dignity of my form that has been pulled out of whack, my spine stacked high with historical memories of warriors and goddesses who bow to no one. And thus begins my transformation to my true self. My skin tears at the mask when I need to hide, pulled off in desperation to expose raw flesh and lack of natural pride. The blood rushes forth, my cheeks hot and reddened, my teeth grinding and gnashing, clenching and clawing. The pinpoint precision of the crumb cadence of my heart pounding through my temples. My eyes tired and weary, stinging. Full of fiery rage. Singing to the tops of my lungs. My body in all-consuming agony, and there is nowhere left to go than to leave this fallacy. I look at my complicity in fostering my oppression. I see the carnage wrought through this repression. I reflect on the photo album of my memories, and I realize that my smile has only been half measured. There for the moment and not real, and it all becomes too much. I look at my complicity in fostering this oppression. I see the carnage bought through this oppression. I reject the notion that this relationship has ever worked for my benefit, and so I will call you out by name with no terms of endearment or forgiveness. Racism, misogyny, white supremacy, capitalism, bigotry, race, exploitation, and all your other things on your left-hand family tree. I see you for who and what you are. And I say to you in a loud, clear voice, it was you all along. I will not leave this legacy to my children. I will not place this imprint on future generations for them to believe for a moment this has to be the truth. Their life.